Amanda. Happy Easter. I just wanted to check in to see how you guys are doing and if you needed anything.
Hi, Cheryl. Oh, it's so good to hear your voice. Mm. We're hanging in there. How about you and Bob?
Oh, we're doing okay. I mean, Bob's adjusting to working online, and I'm trying to motivate myself to do the projects I never get to when I'm working. So how's it going with you and the kids at home?
Well, they haven't killed each other yet, but it's gotten pretty dicey there a few times.
Oh, no. A little rough, huh?
Let's put it this way. Madison is irritated if Austin even breathes in her general direction. So, of course, he won't leave her alone.
Of course.
Lily doesn't get the whole social distancing thing and keeps asking me 15 times a day for a play date.
Oh, no. I wish I could come over and give you a break.
I wish you could, too. I miss our walks in the neighborhood.
Well, me too. I mean, I get out most days with the dog, but she's not a stunning conversationalist.
True, but she is a good listener. How are your kids doing? Have you heard from them?
Oh, yeah. We've been texting, and every Sunday afternoon, we've been getting together for a family Zoom meeting. Of course, they can't come home for Easter like we planned.
I know. What a bummer. I'm trying to figure out how to make Easter special for the kids since they canceled the village Easter egg hunt. Ugh. Lily was so looking forward to it. Kind of a letdown for her to just hunt eggs in our living room.
You know, why don't you guys come to our church's Easter service?
I thought your church canceled services.
Well, they're holding them online. You should check it out. I'll send you the website address.
I'll think about it. At least it would be a change from watching Octonauts.
Oh, yeah.
I've got to go. Madison and Austin are at it again.
Oh, no. I'll pray for you, Amanda.
You might want to pray for the kids. Thanks for calling.
Okay, bye-bye.
Bye.
Morning. Welcome to Crossroads Online. Happy Easter. He is risen. Oh, of course, couldn't resist. As you can see, I am worshiping in my basement this morning, but I know that we are all together in spirit. So let's just lift up the Lord this morning on this wondrous, wondrous Easter day.
His love that came for us, humbled to a sinner's cross. You broke my shame and sinfulness. You rose again victorious.
Faithfulness can deny through the storm and through the fire. There is truth that sets me free. Jesus Christ, who lives in me. You are stronger, you are stronger. Sin is broken. You have saved me. It is written, Christ is risen.
Jesus, you are Lord of all. No beginning and no end, you're my hope and my defense. You came to seek and save the lost, you paid it.
Forever healed.
sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. The Lamb is overcome. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. The Lamb is overcome. Forever here is glorified. Forever here is lifted high. Forever here is risen. He is alive. He is
Savior and my friend. By your grace I live and breathe to worship you. At the mention of your greatness, in your name I will bow down. In your presence fear is silent, for you wear the victor's crown. Let your glory fill this temple, let your power overflow. By your grace I live.
You have overcome. You Hi, everyone. Happy Easter. I'm Lindy Kabeka, and I just want to welcome you to our Easter services online. Glad that you could join us, even though we can't all be together this year. I'm glad that we can celebrate Easter together virtually. I have a couple of announcements this morning, and the first is I just want to say thank you. Thank you to all of you who have continued to generously give to the ministries at Crossroads during this time. If you'd like more information about how to do that, you can go to our website at crossroadscny.org and press on the Give button, and we'll walk you through the steps on how to do that, or you can just mail a check to the church office as well. And just thank you again for all the sacrificial giving that you do so that we can continue to do the ministries here at Crossroads. Also, a second announcement is we have a new sermon series starting next Sunday. The title of it is I Want to Know What Love Is. So a few of you might have started humming a song right there, but it is based on 1 Corinthians 13. So join us back here next Sunday and we'll get started with that new sermon series. Also, families, if you haven't had a chance yet to check out Easter Jam, it is on the website for Crossroads under Next Gen. Our elementary teachers worked so hard to pull this together, and it is so much fun. There are games, there's a great Easter story, there's a fun song to sing. So make sure you check that out if you haven't already. Again, that's called Easter Jam. You don't want to miss it. And last but not least, coming up, we are going to see some pictures of some representations of Easter that our families have done here at Crossroads. And while you are seeing those on the screen, you're going to be hearing John 20, verses 1 through 18, read by the Sheen children. So I just want to thank you again for joining us, and I hope everyone just has a great Easter.
John 20. Early on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb. It was still dark. She saw that the stone had been moved away from the entrance. So she ran to Simon Peter and another disciple, the one Jesus loved. She said, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb. We don't know where they have put him."
So Peter and the other disciple started out for the tomb. Both of them were running. The other disciple ran faster than Peter. He reached the tomb first. He bent over and looked in at the strips of linen lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came along behind him. He went straight into the tomb. He saw the strips of linen lying there. He also saw the funeral cloth that had been wrapped around Jesus' head. The cloth was still lying in its place. It was separate from the linen. The disciple who had reached the tomb first also went inside. He saw and believed. They still did not understand from Scripture that Jesus had to rise from the dead. Then the disciple went back to where they were staying.
But Mary stood outside the tomb crying. As she cried, she bent over to look into the tomb. She saw two angels dressed in white. They were seated where Jesus' body had been. One of them was where Jesus' head had been laid. The other sat where his feet had been placed. They asked her, "Woman, why are you crying? They have taken my Lord away." She said, "I don't know where they have put him." Then she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she didn't realize that it was Jesus. He asked her, "Woman, why are you crying? Who are you looking for?" She thought he was the gardener, so she said, "Sir, did you carry him away? Tell me where you put him, then I will go and get him." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned toward him. Then she cried out in the Aramaic language, "Rabboni." Rabboni means teacher. Jesus said, "Do not hold on to me. I have not yet ascended to the Father. instead go to those who believe in me. Tell them I am ascending to my Father, and your Father to my God, and your God. Mary Magdalene went to the disciples with the news. She said, I have seen the Lord, and she told them that he had said these things to her.
Hello?
Hi, Bob. It's Amanda. Is Cheryl there? Oh, I guess that's kind of a dumb question. Everybody's home these days.
Oh, hi, Amanda. Cheryl stepped out for a second. She's out letting the dogs out.
I just wanted to let her know that we're watching your church service.
Oh, that's great. She said you guys were talking about it. So what do you think?
It's different than I expected. A lot less formal. The kids' videos were so cute, and the music is amazing.
The music's great every week. It's even better in person. You know, Mick's a really great guy, too, and he's a really good speaker. You just got to put up with his Navy stories.
Well, nobody's perfect. We're enjoying it so far, but I don't want to keep you guys. I just wanted to let Cheryl know we tuned in.
Well, she'll be thrilled. I'll have her call you.
Thanks. Talk to you soon.
All right. Say hello to Jim for me. Bye.
Just a minute and offer our prayers to God in the quietness of the moment, in the quietness of your own heart. Just lay your heart out to Him. Thank you. to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether to say that you're my God.
Thank you, Steve, for guiding us through that time of reflection and prayer along with the song. I'm really encouraged by the whole team and all that's been done. And again, here we are on Easter morning, and we're experiencing this in a new way. So thank you, tech team, musicians, everyone who's going to be a part of this. And it's going on with our children's ministry and the Next Gen ministry, and how blessed we are with the creativity and the efforts that everyone's been putting forth on this. But I want to start with our traditional Easter greeting, okay? Let's try it. He is risen. I'm guessing most of you replied to me, he is risen indeed. Now, why is that important? Why does it matter? Well, I think it's one of those things that we refer to in our day and age as a game changer. And I've experienced some game changers during my lifetime, and many of you have as well. And they're kind of places that mark out history going in a certain direction and then having it change. Now, one of the first ones for me, and interestingly, I don't remember this at all, but Syracuse has been celebrating this, and notice the game changers kind of implies a sports metaphor. And Syracuse has been celebrating this week the invention of the 24-second clock in the NBA, which started here in Syracuse with the Syracuse Nationals. Yes, you younger generation, there used to be an NBA team in Syracuse. Of course, I was in pre-K at the time, so I don't remember any of that. Moving ahead to my school years, I remember a lot during the tumultuous 1960s. There was a game changer when we had the Cuban Missile Crisis. Everyone started building shelters in their homes and storing food for the possible nuclear war. And then there was the assassinations, President Kennedy, his brother Bobby, and Martin Luther King. Then there was the unpopular Vietnam War, and the accumulation of those events in the 1960s that were all game changers kind of took this acceptance of everything being very patriotic during the 1950s and the Eisenhower administration as they looked to a leader who had been a great leader in World War II. And now it was skepticism. That skepticism deepened with another game changer that happened with the Nixon Watergate conspiracy and all of listening to the tapes. Then we had the Iran hostage crisis, and things were really, really low. Then the 1980s, there was the economic boom of Reaganomics. And then in the middle of that, another game changer called the Iran-Contra affair. And then the wall fell, and suddenly the United States was the only superpower left standing, so to speak. Then, of course, many will remember 2001, September 11th, and there was the game changer when now the adversary was no longer wearing a different uniform and confined by boundaries, but the enemy could be anywhere, could be next to you in line as you get checked out at the airport. And so those were big game-changing things. And what we're experiencing right now has been a game changer. The experience of this coronavirus. But all of these, even with all of the confinement we've experienced and all of the fact that most of us are thinking that these things are going to change the future as well, they pale in comparison to the game-changing nature of the resurrection of Jesus Christ that transcends the grave, that goes on into eternity, sending what we're describing in cosmology these days as the gravitational waves. Well, the resurrectional waves go on into eternity for all who will trust in Him. So what we're going to do today is we're going to take a look at the facts of the resurrection first, because they are essential to our belief. And then we're going to look at why those matter so much. And in between, we're going to have an awesome musical interlude that I know you're going to enjoy. So let's take a look at where we're going. And this is something I just wanted to put up here as just an acknowledgement that this game-changing thing is not just external, it's not just to the world, but it's to us as individuals. This reflects how the resurrection makes me feel, and I hope and pray that it makes you feel as well. Psalm 30, verses 11 and 12. And I encourage you to read the whole psalm because it's this kind of encouraging. But I know this is going to make you think of something as I read it. "You turn my wailing into dancing. You remove my sackcloth and clothe me with joy, that my heart may sing your praises and not be silent. Lord my God, I will praise you forever." We have a worship song that every time we sing it, it just really gets me going. And it's based on these two verses from Scripture. So this is where I am right now today because of the resurrection. That no matter what's happening around us, we can hang on to this event and we can know that it's true. So we're going to look at essential faith because ultimately Christianity has its foundation not in a philosophy, not in words, but in an event. Now, the words that were written down have preserved this event for us, but the event is factual and historical. It's not mythological. It's not some analogy. It's not a moral lesson or a parable or a proverb. It is an event that happened. And that's what our faith is built on. And the records of Jesus' life tell us exactly what we need to know about it. Now, if you have your Bible with you, or if you want to get out your device, now's a good time to do that. Maybe put me on pause for a moment and get out 1 Corinthians, Paul's first letter to the church in Corinth, in chapter 15. And he's writing to them because they've come to him with problems that they're dealing with. And the last one that he deals with in chapter 15 is the issue of the resurrection. So here's what he says to them in response to a question that's basically asking, hey, is there a resurrection? Has it already happened? And he's going to clarify it very, very well. "For what I received, I passed on to you." So this is something that he didn't know for a long time in his life, but he received it. "I pass on to you as of first importance." This, if you don't get anything else about Christianity, get this right. He says that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures. So he's talking about an event, and he's talking about the fact that that event had been predicted in Old Testament Scriptures, and that he was buried, another part of the event, and that he was raised on the third day according to the Scriptures, that his death, his burial, and his resurrection were predicted in the Old Testament, and they happened just the way he said. And now it says, "and that he appeared to Cephas," or Peter, "and then to the 12, to the disciples. And after that, he appeared to more than 500 of the brothers and sisters at the same time, most of whom are still living, though some have fallen asleep. Then he appeared to James," that would be his half-brother James, "then to all the apostles. And last of all, he appeared to me also, as to one abnormally born." So let's take a look at what these verses tell us. First of all, Jesus truly died. He didn't swoon and sort of die and then fool everybody by coming back from being crucified. The disciples didn't steal his body. 500 people were not hallucinating the same thing at the same time. All of which have been theories to try to deny the death and the resurrection of Jesus. He truly died. People just didn't survive crucifixion by the Romans. And most people died of crucifixion without experiencing the scourging or the lashes that Jesus did beforehand. So his body would have been so depleted, because some people would even die just from the scourging, and he was near death at the end of the scourging, and then he was crucified in addition to it. There's no question that he died. The historians, not only of the Gospels, but contemporary historians who were secular historians, record that there was the death of Christus, a man in Palestine at the time. And so the history then, even today, secular historians who have no desire to prove that Jesus is God or anything like that, still record that Jesus definitely died on that cross. And so we can go to the bank with this truth. Jesus truly died. In fact, his followers thought that all was lost. They'd given up. They had assumed that their movement was done. They were confused. They were frightened. In fact, the scripture that was read today tells us in Luke's gospel that women were the first ones to go to the tomb. Why do you suppose that was? I think the men were too afraid to show their face in public. They didn't have the faith at that point to believe that what Jesus had predicted to them multiple times had really come true, because they saw and knew how dead he was on that cross. And they'd seen his body lifelessly taken down, wrapped, and put in a tomb. And even those who went to his tomb first, Mary Magdalene, they weren't expecting what they saw. They weren't expecting him to rise again. Their faith hadn't gone that far yet, but the resurrection brought that back. His followers thought that all was lost, and the resurrection changed everything. Those same disciples who before that were quaking in fear, when he came and stood among them and they were able to touch and feel and to know that his body was no longer in that tomb, no longer subject to the death he had experienced on that cross, it changed everything for them. And the one who's writing these words, the Apostle Paul, he experienced, as he described in that passage, the resurrection presence of Jesus Christ in the flesh, just in a glorified body, as he was on his way to wreak havoc among Jesus' followers in Damascus. And this man who had literally supervised the execution and the martyrdom of Stephen became the greatest advocate for the church and the greatest church planter who's ever lived, because his whole understanding of the Old Testament was transformed when he was confronted by the resurrected Christ, the resurrected Messiah that he had hoped for and now he understood had come, had died, and now he saw all of that come to fruition. Everything that he had thought about the Old Testament in the past had changed, and he now understood it in light of the resurrection. And it all made sense to him. And when you read his writings, you understand how comprehensively the Old Testament is fulfilled in the resurrection, the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. So at this point, we're going to have an amazing song. Brent, thank you for singing it. And if you stop and think about this man, Saul, or Paul, if you will, he was everything but a peaceful person. He was one who was ready to kill if he needed to. He was hostile toward everything. And in fact, I'm convinced that even his relationship with God was not at peace, because if you read Romans chapter 7, you realize that it was a man who was trying to please God by his own efforts and works and could not, and he had no inner peace. And now we're going to hear Brent sing a song about the peacemaker.
maker, soul soother, storm smoother, light shiner, lost finder, cloud lifter, strength secure my soul. Let your peace take hold in me. Let your wisdom guide my will. Your compassion fill this place. Let my anxious thoughts be still. Let your peace rule in my heart. I need you. I need you. I need you in my life, Lord, I trust.
Thanks, Brent. What an inspiring song, and how that kind of lifts me up. I don't know about you, but to think of all that Jesus is to us in terms of bringing us peace inside, peace with God, and the peace that we can have with one another, because as we are forgiven, we then become able to forgive others. Now let's take a look at where this goes. The resurrection faith is essential to true faith. So now, as we live, let's take a look at another section of 1 Corinthians that talks about what if there wasn't any resurrection? And the Apostle Paul gets very animated. You can tell by what he writes here, because he understands that everything of the Christian faith hinges on not only Jesus' resurrection, but because of Jesus' resurrection and us being in Him, it is the promise of the resurrection that we own. 1 Corinthians 15 goes on, starting with verse 12. But if it is preached that Christ has been raised from the dead, and that is what Paul has been preaching, how can some of you say that there is no resurrection of the dead? Basically, Paul's saying, look, don't you remember what I said when I was with you? He says, if there is no resurrection of the dead, let's just presume, Paul's saying, for argument's sake, that these people are accurate in what they're saying, then not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, our preaching is useless, and so is your faith. Wow. And then he goes on, more than that, we are then found to be false witnesses about God, for we have testified about God that He raised Christ from the dead, but He did not raise Him if, in fact, the dead are not raised. In other words, there were people who were basically saying, this resurrection stuff is just a myth. It kind of is something kind of like their ancient mythology that was associated with Greek and Roman mythology. And, you know, you can't believe that part of it. I mean, Jesus was a good teacher and all those things, but don't believe that resurrection stuff. It's just a good moral code for this life. For if the dead are not raised, then Christ has not been raised either. And if Christ has not been raised, imagine if the event didn't happen, how different things would be. Your faith is futile. You are still in your sins. In other words, we don't have that peace with God. And because we're still in our sin, we don't have any reason of being forgiven to be forgiving to others. Then those who have fallen asleep, our hope for those that we know who are followers of Christ, the hope for them, it is lost. If only for this life we have hope in Christ, we are of all people most to be pitied. What does he mean by that? He had given up a lot. He had suffered over and over again. The persecution that he had been dishing out, he had poured out on him, the Apostle Paul. Why? Because he believed that his rewards and his experience and his hope for the future was going to be directly connected to the resurrection of Jesus Christ. So, notice what he says to confirm the argument. But Christ has indeed been raised from the dead. The first fruits, and it implied in that is that you, his followers, become the rest of the fruits of those who have fallen asleep. So let's look at the significance for us. First of all, the resurrection confirms Jesus as Savior and as God. First, as Savior. He became the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. But the reason it confirms him as Savior is not because he died, but because the resurrection proves that his sacrifice was sufficient for all, that he died for all. And all who come to him by faith are saved by him. And it's the resurrection that proves that. It also proves that he was God. You know, for several weeks before he was arrested and put to death by the Sanhedrin and the Romans, he had been telling his disciples, look, I'm going to Jerusalem. They're going to arrest me and they're going to put me to death by crucifixion. He even told them how. And then on the third day, I'm going to rise. So basically, he proved it because who but God could possibly make that happen? He was able to take the enemies of who he was and his movement and use them sovereignly as divinity to make this happen. That is God. That's no ordinary human being. He had the message from the Father. He had been with the Father. He mentioned earlier, as we talked about earlier in the conflict with the religious leaders, that he had come from God before he was born. So the resurrection is essential to that. It is the expectation of true faith. Faith is not about getting a better moral code to live by. Jesus was a great teacher, but he was far more than that. He was a great example, but he was far more than that. Jesus is the expectation of true faith. And the hope and the confidence that you have as a follower of Jesus is that as he was raised, we too will be raised. That the grave is no longer a final destination. It is a portal to eternal life with God face to face. And then it is the motivation for victory over the trials we will experience when we serve him. The Apostle Paul was one who wrote about that extensively. When he wrote back to the Corinthians a second time, he laid out all these things he'd experienced because they were dissing him. They were not listening or respecting or holding his authority in mind when they heard from him. And he talks about how this is a motivation for victory over the trials of service. It will be challenging. There are things that we do as followers of Jesus that don't make sense if it all ends at the grave. As a matter of fact, listen to what Paul wrote later. If I fought wild beasts in Ephesus, which apparently he did, with no more than human hopes, in other words, if it all ends at the grave, what have I gained if the dead are not raised? And then he says, let us eat and drink, for tomorrow we die. In other words, why would you make sacrifices in this life? Why would you limit any of your appetites? Why would you take any risks if there is no resurrection? And then later on, in the same chapter, he writes this. And I've read this many times when I've done services for people who have passed away. And he says this, the sting of death is sin. In other words, if we had no sin, we wouldn't fear death, would we? And the power of sin is the law. If we were living under the law, if we had to keep the law, then we would still be under sin. But Jesus' death brought in grace, and it fulfilled the law so that it no longer has that sting. But thanks be to God, he gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ, and it's proven by his resurrection, that victory over sin and death. And then he says, as a result of that, therefore, my dear brothers and sisters, stand firm, serve wholeheartedly, serve sacrificially, serve in a way that points toward eternity, not toward things in this life. Let nothing move you. Always give yourselves fully to the work of the Lord because you know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. Friends, Resurrection Day, celebration time. We are filled with joy today. Why? Because we know that the one who went to the cross for us also was risen from the dead. And we can expect, not because of anything we've done, but because we are in him, that in Christ, we have that same victory over sin and death. You know, there is a virus that's been around much longer than the coronavirus. And that virus is the networking of spreading of the good news about who Jesus is and what the effect his life has on your life. And it's exact opposite. It doesn't bring death. It brings eternal life. I celebrate with you today. Jesus is risen. He is risen indeed. God bless and enjoy this Resurrection Sunday.
Oh. O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made,
I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed.
Then sings my soul.
Father in heaven, thank you for the opportunity we have today to be reminded 2 millennia later that the effect of the resurrection is the biggest game changer of all. That human history was not the same before it, and it will never be the same again because eternal life is now available by grace and mercy in Christ. We thank you for that fact, and we rest joyfully today knowing the victory that he's won, and we recognize that his death for us is worthy of our greatest service. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless.
Hi, Amanda. It's me again. Hey, Bob told me you guys watched the service. So what did you think?
Everybody liked it. Austin said it was way cooler than Grandma's church. And Madison actually agreed with him, which is a miracle in itself.
Oh, wow. So maybe when this whole social distancing thing is over, you guys might want to come with us.
We like that. And I think we're going to watch the next sermon series. It sounded really interesting. And it gives us something to look forward to next Sunday.
Well, that's great. I'm so glad you guys liked it.
Thanks for telling us about it.
Oh, you're welcome. And Amanda, if you guys need anything, please just give us a call.
I will. Happy Easter, Cheryl.
Happy Easter.